الله على النبي الأمي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين يا ربي صلي وسلم دائما أبدا على حبيبك خير الخلق كلهم. The Sahabi we are to discuss is that Sahabi whom Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم said is the most knowledgeable regarding the masail of halal and haram. So imagine his seniority. He will come on the day of Qiyamah as the Imam of the Ulama on the day of judgment, whom is the son of. Let's just go through his mother. His mother was a famous woman in our history who embraced Islam in the early stages of deen, and she had a great impact on her son. The mother of this great Sahabi was Asma bint Amr bin Adi bin Yasir bin Sawa bin Ghanam bin Ka'ab bin Salama al-Ansariya al-Sulamiya radiyallahu ta'ala anha. For us to remember, Asma bint Amr, and her title was Ummu Mani'. She participated in the Bay'atul Aqaba. Bay'atul Aqaba is where 73 men and 2 women radiyallahu ta'ala anhum came to present their khidmat to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the 13th year after Hijrah. A 13th year after Nubuwa, and to request Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam to make his way to Medina Munawwara and request him that we will give our life in the service of deen and in defending Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Imagine the jazba, the desire for deen and the love for deen and sacrifice in these sahaba radiyallahu anhum. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam met with them at Aqaba after midnight, and he took bay'ah from them, and they asked what's in it for us. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam said to them, it is jannah for y'all. They were very, very happy. They didn't ask for dunya. They were not promised dunya. They were pleased with that deal they made with Allah Ta'ala and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. These two women were namely Ummu Umara was one, Nusayba binti Ka'ab radiyallahu anha, and the other was this woman who we are speaking about, whose son we are speaking about, Asma bint Amr radiyallahu ta'ala anha. She is known as her kunya, and her appellation, her kunya was Ummu Mani' radiyallahu ta'ala anha. Imagine this mother, how much of love she had for deen, that she comes to present her services to Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this very, very important bay'ah. Allahu Akbar. So much of qurbani she gave that she prepared for the ummah a young man who would serve Allah Ta'ala's deen, who would strive in Allah Ta'ala's path, who was referred to by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam as the Imam of the Ulama on the Day of Judgment. Who is this son of hers? Her son is none other than the great Sahabi Muaz bin Jabal radiyallahu ta'ala anhu. Muaz bin Jabal radiyallahu anhu participated in the bay'ah of Aqaba with his mother and with the other Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, who were approximately 73 men and 2 women. They were so happy. He was so thrilled with the fact that he had the opportunity to meet Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Because from the beginning stages, even before they had met Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam on that occasion, Muaz bin Jabal radiyallahu anhu was attending the discourses, the ta'aleem, the teachings of Mus'ab bin Umayr radiyallahu anhu and Abdullah bin Ummi Maktum radiyallahu anhu. And Muaz radiyallahu anhu's iman was so strong that he would work amongst his people in eradicating the worship of idols from amongst them. He tried to convince them on the uselessness and the baselessness of these idols. لا يملكون لأنفسهم ضرا ولا نفعا ولا يملكون موتا ولا حياة ولا نشورا. That Allah is doing and creation cannot do. That all the creation, the idols and everyone and everything else cannot even own or are not even able to bring harm or benefit to themselves, leave alone anybody else. Nor can they bring any life or death upon themselves, leave alone anything or anybody else. So Mu'adh radiallahu anhu was involved in this from the beginning. Himself, Tha'alaba bin Anama, Abdullah bin Unais radiallahu anhum would make this fikr amongst the Banu Salima tribe and to remove the worship of idols amongst them. Mu'adh radiallahu anhu had few good friends whom together they had embraced Islam. They were the children of Amr bin Jamuh. One incident just to make us understand how Mu'adh radiallahu anhu had fikr. And he used his youthful instincts to actually bring people to Allah's deen and make people understand the truth. So Mu'adh radiallahu anhu, this is Mu'adh bin Jabal this lion of Allah, this mighty Sahabi, this great scholar who we are discussing, and his friends who were youth, Muaz bin Amr bin Jamuh, Khalad, a few of them, they're making fikr, that how can we make my friend's father understand that the idols cannot do. So together they come up with an idea. The father's name was Amr bin Jamuh, and he was devoted to worshipping his idol called Manat. And what they would do is, this was a senior person in the area. So what they did was, when Amr bin Jamuh went to sleep, they took his big idol Manat and they put it in the dump. Actually, to make their father realize and understand that this cannot do. And this is in need. This is a makhluq. This is a creation. It's a created thing. How can you worship something created? You have to worship the creator. Al-Khaliq, the creator. So Mu'adh radiallahu anhu and his friends were trying to convince Amr radiallahu anhu of this. So in this, he wakes up in the morning and he's enraged because he first goes to his idol. And actually he was a man who was quite crippled, lame, completely lame on the one foot. So he would hop on one foot only. He finds the idol not in its place. Now in a fit of rage, he gathers whoever he could, his servants and whatever, and they're in search of this idol. Who has transgressed upon my God this night? Who has done so? Who has done so? And he finally found it in one dump. He took it out. He washed it, bathed it, you know, cleansed it, perfumed it. And he says, by Allah, if I only knew who did this to you, I will definitely disgrace him. Actually, they would believe in Allah as they take oath here, by Allah, wallah. But they worshipped others besides Allah as partners. This is something Allah does not tolerate. Anyway, they did this the first night. The second day, before Amr goes to sleep, he worships his deity. And then he then goes to sleep. And they do the same thing the second time. The third time they do the same thing, but before Amr goes to sleep, this time he says to his God, you know, please, I can't take them doing this to you. Okay, you're supposed to be defending me, but okay, if you can't defend me, at least defend yourself. I'm leaving my sword with you. So already his faith on these idols was becoming shaky. He was weakening his, they were weakening his faith on the idols for him then to understand that Allah is the controller. And this is a lesson for us with our friends, with our colleagues. What we have to do is slowly, slowly explain to them, Allah is doing everything and Allah is one and Allah has no partner. And that which is created is in need. So slowly, slowly get them to understand, break their faith in makhluq, in created entities. Ya ayyuhan nas, duriba mathalun fastami'u lah. Quran so beautifully declares, O humanity, an example is being expounded to you. So listen to it attentively. Inna alladhina tad'una min dunillah lan yakhluqu dhubaban walaw ijtama'u lah. All those that you turn to besides Allah can never ever create even one tiny fly. Dhubaban. Dhubar is a fly. وَلَوْ اجْتَمَعُوا. Even if they all join forces to do so, they will never ever be able to accomplish it. Then Allah says, وَإِن يَسْلُبْهُمُ الذُّبَابُ شَيْئًا. Leave alone creating the fly. If all the superpowers of the world rally their forces and put their strength together and their ideas together, if the fly has to just take something very, very minimal from them, all of the makhluk together can never take back from the fly what the fly took from them. Da'ufa al-talibu wal-matloob. They are weak, and those whose gazes on them are weak. All the makhluk is weak, and those who turn to makhluk are weak. One Allah is powerful. So we have to weaken mankind's reliance on makhluk and then explain to them that everything is from Allah. They do the same thing. The next day when he gets up, he searches for his idol and he finds it in the dump, in the sewage. And what he does now, he realizes his mistake all along and he says, Tallahi law kunta ilahan lam takun anta wa kalbun wastabirin fi qaran uffin limasra'ika ilahan mustadan al-ana fattashnaka an su'il ghaban alhamdulillahi al-aliyyid al-minan al-wahib al-razzaqi dayyan al-diyan. He makes tawbah to Allah Ta'ala in such amazing words where he praises Allah and thanks Allah Ta'ala that Allah Ta'ala Ta'ala guided him in spite of his old age. And he fell down in sajda for Allah Ta'ala. أَتُوبُ إِلَى اللَّهِ مِمَّا مَضَى وَأَسْتَنْقِذُ اللَّهَ مِنْ نَارِهِ. And then read this in the Hayat al-Sahaba, volume 1. It's so beautiful what Sahaba radiallahu anhu would do, different ways of bringing people to Allah Ta'ala's deen through different methods, through different ways. It's really amazing. So Muad bin Jabal radiallahu anhu was really influential in bringing the senior of their area to Islam. He helped the sons of Amr bin Jamuh until Amr bin Jamuh became such a great Sahabi radiallahu anhu. So Muaz bin Jabal owned his life. He was devoted to connecting humanity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah give us tawfiq to do the same and emulate this great Sahabi and the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Muaz radiallahu anhu had a lot of concern for humanity. There's reports that the people of Medina, Munawwara, would very often hear from the Jews about the arrival of the final messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, to such an extent that was one of the reasons why they patiently remained in Medina Munawwara. And very often they would hear, the people of Medina Munawwara would hear, that the Jews would threaten the Aus and the Khazraj, that when the final Nabi of Allah comes, we will follow him, his time is close, and with him, نَقْتُلُكُمْ مَعْهُ قَتْلَ عَادٍ وَإِرَمْ. Like the nations of Aad and Iram were destroyed, like that with the final Nabi of Allah will destroy you people, meaning referring to the people of Medina Munawwara. These ultimatums the Jews would give when they wouldn't get their way. But when the people of Medina Munawwara embraced Islam, and the Jews were very, very upset, and they had their hatred and ill feelings, and very, very sad was the condition of the Jews, that they were known to be people of Tawheed, but they didn't spread this Tawheed, this oneness of Allah, this belief in the oneness of Allah. Even they saw that the mushrikeen were on falsehood. They saw that the mushrikeen were worshipping idols. They still didn't tell them that worship Allah, the one and only, and Allah is one. Allah save us in today's times, where we see people worshipping idols, ascribing partners unto Allah Ta'ala. We don't explain to them, we don't tell them what is right, we don't convince them. Many a time these are people under our employment, or people who we hold friendships with, but we say nothing. Really, respected elders and respected listeners, this is an injustice. Do not become like the Jews in this regard. Anyway, Mu'adh radiallahu anhu would go to the Jews, and he would tell them, and they would tell many of the Jews, himself and Bishr bin Bara would make this fikr and concern and go to them. In one discussion, Mu'adh radiallahu anhu says to the group of Jews, they were together somewhere having some discussion, Mu'adh radiallahu anhu went to visit them. And he says to them, Ya ma'ashara Yahud, ittaqu Allah wa aslimu, fear Allah and embrace Islam. You all used to actually seek Allah's assistance against us through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when we were people of idolatry, when we were mushrikeen. And you all would inform us that when he comes, you all will follow him. You all even described him to us. قَدْ كُنْتُمْ تَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَيْنَا بِمُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَنَحْنُ أَهْلُ شِرْكٍ وَتُخْبِرُونَنَا أَنَّهُ مَبْعُوثٌ وَتَصِفُونَهُ لَنَا بِصِفَتِهِ. You all would describe him to us. How can you all now turn against the truth? Come to the truth now. Mu'adh radiallahu anhu is explaining to the Jews. Salam bin Mishkam from the Banu Nadir tribe, he showed his disapproval and says, no, this is not the Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam we know that we describe to you. And then Allah revealed verses of the Quran. وَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ كِتَابٌ مِّنْ عِنْدِ اللَّهِ مُصَدِّقٌ لِمَا مَعَهُمْ وَكَانُوا مِنْ قَبْلُ يَسْتَفْتِحُونَ عَلَى الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَلَمَّا جَاءَهُمْ مَا عَرَفُوا كَفَرُوا بِهِ فَلَعْنَةُ اللَّهِ عَلَى الْكَافِرِينَ. In Surah Baqarah, ayat number 89. When the book of Allah came to them, confirming what they have, and they used to, from before, seek Allah's assistance against the disbelievers. And they would seek Allah's assistance in the tafaseer through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam against the disbelievers. When the truth which they recognized came to them, they denied it. So may Allah's curse be upon the disbelievers. In another report, this Allama Suyuti rahimahullah mentions in his Asbabun Nuzul, that Mu'adh bin Jabal, Sa'ad bin Mu'adh, Kharija bin Zayd radiyallahu anhum, they went to the Jewish rabbis and asked them about verses from the Torah describing Janabi Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And the Jews concealed the reality and they refused to inform them any of this. And then the verses of Quran that were revealed
إن الذين يكتمون ما أنزلنا من البينات والهدى من بعد ما بيناه للناس في الكتاب أولئك يلعنهم الله ويلعنهم اللاعنون.
Those who conceal what we reveal from the clear signs and the guidance after we clarified it to the people in the books, such people who conceal the truth, such people are those that Allah has cursed, and the curses cursed them, meaning Allah's creation also cursed them, meaning the animal kingdom and Allah Ta'ala's creation, the malaika also cursed them because they concealed the truth. Allah save us also, respected listeners, from concealing the truth. Make it available to humanity. Give it to humanity. Don't conceal haqq from humanity. Don't conceal Quran from people also. And Muaz radiallahu anhu knew their plots, so he took on his shoulders the responsibility of sharing the truth to humanity in many, many ways. So this was one of the many, many traits of Muaz radiallahu anhu. In the books of Sirah, it's mentioned that Muaz radiallahu anhu went with his revered, respected, beloved teacher, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, our Nabi, to visit the Jews. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invited them to Islam and encouraged them towards the truth and warned them of the punishment and the outcome of defying and denying the truth. They all refused and they disbelieved and they denied. So Mu'adh radiallahu anhu, including Sa'ad bin Ubadah and Uqba bin Wahab radiallahu anhum, told them, O Jews, fear Allah, by Allah, you all know that He is the Nabi of Allah. You all informed us of Him so many times, even before His arrival. And you all described Him to us with His attributes and descriptions. وَلَقَدْ كُنْتُمْ تَذْكُرُونَهُ لَنَا قَبْلَ مَبْعَثِهِ وَتَصِفُونَهُ لَنَا بِصِفَتِهِ. So these Jews, Rafi' bin Khuraymila, Wahab bin Yahuda, said, we didn't say this ever. وَمَا أَنزَلَ اللَّهُ مِنْ كِتَابٍ بَعْدَ مُوسَى. And there's no such a thing that there's a book after Musa alayhi salam. No, has Allah sent a Bashir or a Nadir, a giver of glad tidings or a warner. So Allah revealed verses of the Quran. So many verses of Quran in this regard. يَا أَهْلَ الْكِتَابِ قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ رَسُولُنَا يُبَيِّنُ لَكُمْ عَلَى فَتْرَةٍ مِّنَ الرُّسُلِ أَن تَقُولُوا مَا جَاءَنَا مِن بَشِيرٍ وَلَا نَذِيرٍ فَقَدْ جَاءَكُمْ بَشِيرٌ وَنَذِيرٌ وَاللَّهُ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٌ. O people of the book, our messenger has come to you, explaining to you, after a long period when no anbiya came, he came to explain the truth to you, lest you should say, that you shouldn't say that a Bashir and a Nadir has not come to us, a giver of glad tidings, and a warner has not come to us. This is something you shouldn't say. For indeed a Bashir and a Nadir has come to you from Allah, and Allah has power over everything. So there's so many reports that Mu'ad radiallahu anhu was involved in this fikr. Mu'ad radiallahu anhu was a Sahabi of extreme beauty. He was very, very handsome. Allah Ta'ala blessed him with زَادَهُ اللَّهُ بَسْطَةً فِي الْعِلْمِ وَالْجِسْمِ. Allah increased him with excellent knowledge. He excelled in knowledge, وَالْجِسْمِ. And Allah gave him such a beautiful body. In so many reports of history, Ibn Asakir rahimahullah describes him, كَانَ مُعَاذٌ رَضِيُّ لَنُ مِنْ أَفْضَلِ شَبَابِ الْأَنصَارِ حِلْمًا وَحَيَاءً. He was among the Ansar that excelled most in forbearance, bashfulness, generosity, وضيء الوجه, such a bright, beautiful face, أكحل العينين, his eyes were naturally, it naturally seemed as though he had placed surma in it, براق الثنايا, his mouth and teeth were bright, he was beautiful, جميلا, جميل means beautiful, وسيم means his entire body was beautiful. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would place him behind him on the conveyance, فَكَانَ رَذِيفًا. So he was a companion of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who would sit on the conveyance with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That means radif. Dhahabi rahimahullah describes Sayyiduna Mu'adh radiallahu anhu, كَانَ طَوِيلًا حَسَنًا جَمِيلًا. He was tall, handsome, beautiful. Jabir radiallahu anhu says, كَانَ مُعَادٌ مِنْ أَحْسَنِ النَّاسِ وَجْهًا. Mu'adh radiallahu anhu really had the most beautiful face. وَأَحْسَنِهِمْ خُلُقًا. And he had the most impeccable character. وَأَسْمَحِهِمْ كَفَّى. And he had the most generous palm and hand. He couldn't say no. He would give everything he had. That's what actually caused him to come into so much of debts. Ka'b bin Malik radiallahu anhu, one of the great horsemen of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in the report of Ibn Sa'ad describes him, كَانَ مُعَاضُ بْنُ جَبَلٍ رَضِيُّنَا رَجُلًا طَوِيلًا أَبْيَضٍ حَسَنَ الثَّغْرِ عَظِيمَ الْعَيْنَيْنِ مَجْمُوعَ الْحَاجِبَيْنِ جَعْدًا قَطِيطًا. Tall, bright-faced. His mouth was bright and clean. Teeth were clean and bright. His eyes were huge. He had beautiful eyebrows. And his hair was curly. Yazid bin Qutayb Sakuni says, I entered the Masjid of Hims and I see this young man around whom people were sitting. He had curly hair, and when he spoke, it was like noor and pearls were emanating from his beautiful mouth. So I asked, who is this? Who is this ustad and teacher? They said, this is Muaz ibn Jabalin radiyallahu anhu. Ibn Qudama Maqdisi says, Muaz radiyallahu anhu was a man who practiced deen. He was so virtuous, sayyidan, fadila, amilan, jawada, very, very generous, kareeman, noble, full of generosity, jameela, he was very, very beautiful. And in many, many reports, Shahar bin Hawshab rahimahullah says, even when the Sahaba radiallahu anhu had a discussion, and if Muaz radiallahu anhu was amongst them, they would all look up to him out of awe for him. The Sahaba would consider Muaz radiallahu anhu as their senior. Sahaba radiallahu anhu would consider Muaz radiallahu anhu as their senior. This was Muaz radiallahu anhu's position, status. What awe he held, because he was the scholar, he was the alim, even amongst the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. Because in the ahadith, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, he is the most knowledgeable in regards to halal and haram. And in many aspects of deen, Muaz radiallahu anhu was excellent. He excelled. This hadith, وَأَعْلَمُهُمْ بِالْحَلَالِ وَالْحَرَامِ مُعَاذُ بْنُ جَبَلٍ radiallahu anhu. We hear it every Friday in the khutbah. He excelled in knowledge. Hadith, he will be ahead of all the ulama on the day of Qiyamah. Meaning, he will bear the banner of the ulama. The imam of the ulama, Sayyiduna Muaz bin Jabal radiyallahu anhu. Sahaba radiyallahu anhum loved him. Even Umar radiyallahu anhu. It's mentioned in Al-Istibsar that Umar radiyallahu anhu was sitting with the other Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, and he's telling them, what do you wish for most? Each one say what he aspires for and wishes for, what crosses his mind, whatever he wants. And each one said, I would love this to spend it in Allah's path. I would love that to do for Allah's deen. I would love such resources. Umar radiallahu anhu says, أَتَمَنَّى لَوْ أَنَّ هَذِهِ الدَّارِ مَمْلُوءَةً رِجَالًا مِثْلُ أَبِي عُبَيْدَةَ بْنِ الْجَرَّاحِ وَمُعَاذِ بْنِ جَبَلْ وَسَالِمٍ مَوْلَى أَبِي حُذَيْفَةَ وَحُذَيْفَةَ بْنِ الْيَمَانِ radiallahu anhu. They said, what is your wish, O Amir al-Mu'mineen? What do you aspire for? What would you want most and pine for? He said, I wish this entire building was filled with men. The likes of Abu Ubaidah bin Jarrah, Muaz ibn Jabal, Salim, Mawla Abi Hudayfa, and Hudayfa bin Yaman, radiyallahu anhum, who would help me in the khidmat of humanity, in serving Allah's deen, in striving in Allah's way, in uplifting Allah's deen. This was the wish of Umar radiyallahu anhu, to have an entire building full of men like Muaz bin Jabal, to serve Allah's deen. Abu Idris Khulani says, I entered the Masjid of Hims. There was a halqa taking place consisting of 32 men from the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. And when one of them said, I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, and then he would narrate a hadith. Amongst them was a man, Rajulun Ad'aj. He had black eyes. Barraqu al-thanaya. His mouth was so bright. If the others doubted anything or weren't sure about something, they would refer to him. And when he would past decision, they would all accept what he has to say. I ever sat in a majlis, the like of it, before or after that in my life. And when everyone was had left, I didn't know the name of this man, know where he was staying. So I spent my night, and I'm saying I'm seeking knowledge. And I'm sitting by the Sahaba radiallahu anhum, but I didn't know the name of that man, know where he stays. So in the morning, I went early to the masjid. And when I went early to the masjid, I wanted to meet that man. As I said, I came to study, and I didn't actually verify who this man is. So the next day, I went early to the masjid. And I find the same man who I was looking for there already. So I went near him and I said, "Oh Abu Abdullah, I really, really love you." So he grabbed me by my garment and he pulled me closer to him. And he says, "You really love me?" So I said, "Indeed, by Allah, I most certainly love you for Allah." So he tells me, "I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam say, 'Innal mutahabbina bi jalalillahi fi dhillillahi yawma la dhilla illa dhilluh.' Those who love each other for the grandeur of Allah, for pleasing Allah, Allah Ta'ala will give them such honor. They will be in Allah's shade on the day of Qiyamah, where nobody else will have shade except the one who Allah gives shade to. They will be in Allah's shade." In another report, "Al-mutahabbuna fi Allah," those who love each other for the pleasure of Allah, will be on pulpits of light. Anbiya and shuhada will envy because of their closeness to Allah Ta'ala. After he said this, narrated these ahadith to me, I got up and there was someone else also there. So I said to him, "There's a hadith that this senior person narrated to me." So he said, "What did he tell you?" Because he only speaks what is haqq. So I informed the second individual what the first one said. So he said, "Yes, I also heard that from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But I'll tell you another hadith more virtuous. I heard Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam narrate from Allah a hadith qudsi. حَقَّتْ مَحَبَّتِي لِلَّذِينَ يَتَبَادَلُونَ فِيَّ. My love is confirmed for those who spend it on each other for my pleasure. And my love is confirmed for those who visit each other for my pleasure. وَحَقَّتْ مَحَبَّتِي لِلَّذِينَ يَتَزَاوَرُونَ فِيَّ. In another report of Musnad, Musnad Ahmad, حَقَّتْ مَحَبَّتِي لِلْمُتَحَابِّينَ فِيَّ. My love is confirmed for those who love each other for my pleasure. وَحَقَّتْ مَحَبَّتِي لِلْمُتَبَادِلِينَ فِيَّ. And my love is confirmed and for those who spend on each other for my pleasure. And my love is confirmed for those who befriend each other for my pleasure. And those who join ties for my pleasure." So I say to him, "Who are you? May Allah have mercy on you." He says, "Ana Ubadah ibn Samit radiyallahu anhu." I am Ubadah bin Samit. And who is that senior person who I went to? He said, "This is Muaz bin Jabal." That is Muaz bin Jabal radiyallahu anhu. Wahwa, how Sahaba were available to humanity. You want to find Sahaba? Where were they found? They were found in masjid. A tabi'i, a student wanted to find the sahabi, he goes to the masjid, he finds the seniors there. Allah give us tawfiq. Most salient traits of Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu was his knowledge of the Qur'an al-Kareem. He was a scholar of the Qur'an al-Kareem. Anas radiyallahu anhu reports that in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's time, from the Ansar, the most senior in regards to Qur'an was Ubay ibn Ka'ab, Mu'adh ibn Jabal, Zayd ibn Thabit, and Abu Zayd radiyallahu ta'ala anhum. Ibn Amr radiyallahu anhuma reports that Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, "Learn the Qur'an, khudul Qur'an min arba'ah," from four individuals, from Abdullah bin Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu, from Ubay bin Ka'ab radiyallahu anhu, from Mu'adh bin Jabal radiyallahu anhu, and from Salim Mawla Abi Hudayfa radiyallahu anhum. So he was a man of the Qur'an al-Kareem. There were occasions where Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would tell the Sahaba radiyallahu anhum, "Isma'u kama sana'a Mu'adh." Do as Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu has done in regards to masail of salah, few miss their salah and so forth. Do as Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu has done. During the blessed lifetime of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu was the imam of his masjid. There's one interesting incident where one of the muqtadis, the musallis in Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu's masjid, came to complain to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu was very, very lengthy in his raka'at, in his fara'id and so forth. This was his love for Qur'an. So Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam called for him and said to him, "O Mu'adh, afattanun anta ya Mu'adh," meaning, "Don't make it difficult for people. It will be fitna for them that they will want to break their salah." Meaning, in the fara'id, read it moderate. And afterwards in nawafil, read as much as possible. For Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam personally did his training of how to be the imam and how to lead the congregation and how to guide the ummah and teach them deen. To such an extent, after the occasion of Fath Makkah, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam left Mu'adh bin Jabal radiyallahu anhu in charge of Makkah Mukarramah to teach the Qur'an al-Kareem and teach the fiqh of the deen of Allah Ta'ala. And Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu was so wise. That's why towards the end of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's life, He sent Muaz radiallahu anhu to teach deen. He sent two great sahaba to Yemen. Allahu Akbar. When Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Muaz radiallahu anhu, and he told Muaz, when you come back, I'll be no more. You will not see me, but you will pass my blessed grave. How Muaz radiallahu anhu cried. How Muaz radiallahu anhu cried. And how emotional was Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Muaz radiallahu anhu was the sahabi whom Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, oh Muaz, I love you. That incident of how Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ushered him out of Madinah Munawwara. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent Muaz bin Jabal and Abdullah bin Qais, Abu Musa al-Ash'ari radiallahu anhuma to Yemen to teach Allah's deen. Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved him, but Allah's Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sacrificed him for the hidayat of mankind. This incident we will continue in the coming discussions. Allah give us tawfiq to emulate Sahaba radiallahu anhum, to follow their beautiful lifestyle. Let's read a few quotes for the glorious Sahaba, Sahabi Muaz radiallahu anhu. وصلى الله على النبي الأمي برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين.